22 was the proposal not resulting in detrimental change in the character of the area. 3, access and services being capable of satisfactory provision, particularly for off-street car parking areas and garages, and adequate vehicle access. And point 5 on that list is the appropriate provision of design features which contribute to a secure environment and reduce the likelihood of crime. On each of these points, I believe the authority would be failing in its duty to allow the application to proceed. Firstly, the hitherto mentioned recreational activities, which add greatly to the character of the area, would be completely stopped by allowing this application to go ahead. The issue of access and services being capable of satisfactory provision is of great concern to me and many residents. Residents along Gainsborough Road, the adjacent road, have on several occasions raised with me their fears for the emergency vehicles getting to the top of that street. As you will know, is where the proposed access for these new dwellings fall. One resident, when I was knocking on doors a couple of months ago, actually was worried when an ambulance couldn't reach the house immediately. Paramedics made the way, the rest of the journey on foot, to tend to a man who had suffered a heart attack, which is greatly concerning. Clearly, the access through Gainsborough is totally unsuitable and would result in endangering lives. On the third point raised, I am concerned about the open space resulting in an increase in antisocial behaviour and crime. Many neighbourhoods enjoy enclosed design, so that there is an opportunity see what is happening and little opportunity for people to disappear quickly. There is a concern that has been raised to me by many residents that this open space leading straight into the woodlands would increase their reach, not decrease it. I therefore believe the application falls foul of policy HS 4. Next is policy URN1, development and urban regeneration. It states that the following types of land or buildings are protected from inappropriate development: sites of ecological or nature conservation importance, and sites commonly required for recreational purposes. I believe I've already set out the reasons why this land is required for recreational purpose, but I would like to raise the issue of the site having to want with regard to nature conservation. Currently on this land, which is listed under proposals NC6 as a site of biological importance, there are 3 species of bats protected under European and British law. The 3 species are set out in a 2007 letter from Dr. Hilary Ash, the Honourable Conservation Officer of Wirral Wildlife, are the nuptial, pipistrelle, and long-eared bat. I don't know if I got them right. We have any bat experts here, please correct me now. Thank you. A relevant policy to this is NC01, Principles for Nature Conservation, which states the local planning authority will only permit proposals which will not adversely affect, directly or indirectly, the integrity of the borough's international, national, and locally designated sites for nature conservation and earth science. It goes on to say that wherever possible, networks of linear natural habitats and other corridors of importance to wildlife will also be retained and protected. This policy makes the letter from Dr. Hilary Ash, the 20th of July, opposing this application, regarding this proposal all the more interesting. In the letter, she states that bat surveys show there is an adequate tree lighting at present. Lighting affects the insects on which the bats feed to the ultimate detriment of both. The application proposes, and at least it did when I last looked at it, additional lighting units, and I understand the updated application includes the installation of bat boxes to provide roosting and foraging opportunities. Very important to you all, I know. I do feel this fails to address Dr. Ash's comments regarding the adverse impact that the additional lighting would have on the insects that the bats use to feed. Approving this application would neglect our legal obligation to honour the protection of these bats. Interestingly, it's this policy, NC7, Species Protection, that states development which would have an adverse effect on wildlife species protected by law will not be permitted unless the local planning authority is satisfied that the protection of the species can be secured through the use of planning conditions and or planning obligations. Following the letter from Dr. Ash, it is clear that this could not be achieved if the planning application continues to suggest additional lighting. Should the suggestion of removing these lights units be mooted, I refer back to HS4 and the need to reduce the likelihood of crime. Clearly would have the opposite effect. Another issue I would like to raise, as members who attended the site visit last month will be aware, is the incredibly narrow access to the site. This creates several very serious issues. It poses a challenge to accommodate construction traffic, but there are also lasting implications if this development were to go ahead. The bungalows that are designated, as we heard earlier, for this site have been done so in mind to house disabled residents. Should this be the case, how could they possibly access their properties by foot safely? Given that the pavement access is very narrow, and an only one car width, the road offers no protection from vehicles, particularly in the winter when it's dark, I am minded to rightly expect if they are unable to safely leave their area. All of this compares with your highways and traffic officer, who in writing the report states the narrow width of the access road would fail to comply with normal standards for residential roads. It seems the only way the Gentle and the Council would be around this is via blocking roads. Given that this process is not yet, and the acknowledgement of myself and residents been completed, I would suggest the planning committee be in breach of national policy by allowing this development. I hope I've clearly laid out the obvious planning reasons that this application should be rejected. I would, before finishing, like to speak to the residents' affinity with this place as well. You would have seen from the previous planning meetings the strength of feeling from both residents. I have been impressed by the togetherness and dedication of Overchurch residents regarding this proposal. I have been contacted by phone, email, letter, and face-to-face by many residents who are fully aware of the application and hold very deep and very legitimate concerns. These residents have sat in several meetings for hours at a time, going through each page of the Rural Unitary Development Plan with me. Their research into the local, national, and international planning model has shown me the meaning of dedication. I am aware for many reasons hundreds of local residents do not wish for this to proceed. I share those concerns and I do urge you to reject this application.
Thank you. A 2 metre footway around the southeast side of the site, closest to the houses, which is sort of standard width that we would apply for a residential road. In terms of our residential road specifications, those to do with the adoptable residential roads, and this road itself isn't of sufficient width for it to be adoptable. That doesn't necessarily mean that it's unsafe. Manual for streets does allow for roads to be reduced to a single width carriageway over short distances. And my view is, with the passing point that's shown in front of the garage there, then the short widths that are either side of that passing point are acceptable in line with the guidance in manual for streets. Now obviously that guidance in manual for streets isn't translated into our adoptable road standard. So the road, from our point of view, cannot be adopted, but it does meet the guidance in manual for streets. So the view to be taken is that the highway safety concerns are not valid for this particular application.
Do any of the commission have any comments?
The comments have been made about cars passing what's the conclusion of highways officer for cars and pedestrians? You pointed out an area of paving that's within the development site. There didn't appear to be any paving from where the dotted road seems to start out into Kingsborough Road. So whilst we might be happy with conflict, if you like, within that road, where would we stand on vehicle and pedestrian, or vehicle and wheelchair, and what of these disabled people, or vehicle and scooter, or vehicle and cyclists, slightly more vulnerable road users, those two cars, facing off having a single access.
Thank you, through you, Chair. I think there's
components to this. One is the potential for a conflict to take place. And given the small number of properties within this road, proposed properties, vehicle movements are going to be very slight, very low. In terms of the footway coming out through the towards Gainsborough Road, there is a section where there's a badly overhanging bush that needs cutting back, and that will reveal the footway underneath, which will be the pedestrians to use. As I say, the main thing we looked at here is what's the potential flow of traffic into the site in terms of vehicle traffic, motor vehicles, and that is deemed to be very low. So as I say, the risk of conflict is minimal. So in those regards, we don't feel there's sustainable grounds for the flow protection. When the bush is cut back, the footway underneath will be a minimum of the 800 millimetres that is required for wheelchair access. Now, obviously, I don't know the particular circumstances of the gentleman in question. I don't know the size of wheelchair or buggy that he uses. Some buggies are larger and are designed to run on the footway or on the carriageway. If it's one of those, then they are designed to run on the carriageway. They have lights, they have indicators, and then all those sorts of things will allow them to do that. And again, I will return to the potential of conflict taking place, which comes around the volume of traffic that's likely to go in and out of the site, which I would contend is going to be very low in this instance.
Chris. Thanks, Anita. There are obviously other issues though that the residents feel very, very passionately about, and which the councillor for the residents has also brought up. So I'd like to just sort of say that I am very concerned that the residents do see this as an area that they use for a lot of different recreational purposes, which seems to be of great importance to the local community. And also, there's been a major plea that's been made by the residents and the councillor for us to take seriously the views around the situation with the bats and the wildlife in the woodland area. So, it isn't just about the specifics of millimeters and cars getting through. There's other issues here which I think have been expressed very passionately, and I'm very mindful to raise that again. Yeah.
Thank you. Chair.
Thank you. through you, Chair, I think the entrance coming in from Gainsborough Road is constricted by the two properties that are there and the pedestrian access that's required into those properties, number 53 and number 55, which is shown on the drawing and on the visualizer there. So I don't think there's much we can do with that stretch from Gainsborough to the passing point. In terms of the width of the road within the site, beyond the passing point, where colleagues were shown, it's indicated on the drawing now, there is some scope there to widen out. I think it measures 3.8 at the moment on the proposal with a 2 metre footway. There is scope to widen that out to allow it to be wide enough to cater for two vehicles to pass each other along that full length there. That would obviously require a narrowing of the footway if it's not to interfere with the design of the houses within the site. But the footway can be narrowed and still be wide enough to be of a minimum width for wheelchair users to pass along it. So that is an option. It still would bring up to adoptable standards, but it would still comply with manual for streets in terms of the guidance that's in that document.
Involved in road adoption situation in the state of India.
many years, and we've always, the local authority has always tried to bring the roads up to, the contractor has always brought the roads up to production standards, so it could be adopted by the local authority. I understand these don't need no challenges, I'm just trying to put another side of the coin. But this, I don't think, because of the access arrangements, is a practical solution. I'm just wondering whether there's any other solution without demolishing those two houses at the end.
Could I just ask both of the officers really to come back on those questions, please? I mean, the site is allocated and designated as a primary residential area, and new housing on such sites is acceptable subject to a number of criteria. In this instance, we feel that certainly the scale, the layout, the design proposal is acceptable, meets all our interface distances, and we raise no objections on any grounds of residential development on the site. No.
Thank you, through you, Chair. In terms of the access into the site, the access that comes in from Gainsborough up to the corner of the number 53 and 55. As I said before, Councillor, there's nothing we can do about that, because we can see that we do need to retain that though as a cottage highway, because it serves as a pedestrian access to number 53 and number 55. If that weren't the case, then we could potentially be looking at stopping that up as well, but that's not the case, so we have to be pragmatic about that. I understand what you say in terms of the space in front of the garage, whether or not that will always be available for vehicles to pass. And the times that I've been out of looking at this application when we had a site visit, if it wasn't parked up with vehicles, that would be guaranteed for the future if there's another issue. In terms of large vehicle access into the site, as I say, the road within the site is shown at 3.8 metres wide on the carriageway, which is only minded to allow a single vehicle to pass, whether that's a car or a large vehicle. If that was widened out to 4.8 metres, then that would allow a car and a large vehicle to pass each other. So, you know, whether or not that's an option, we'd obviously need to lose a metre off the footway to do that, but we'd still retain a 1 metre width of footway, which would be sufficient to allow wheelchairs to pass along it. So whether or not that's an option in terms of conditions, I'd have to defer to my planning colleagues.
Sorry, Chair. I made a diversion. I think we have to look at the application before us. I don't think we can redesign it on the rule. And therefore, we either refuse it on the ground that access provision is inadequate and somebody goes away and comes back with a better design, or we approve it for all the reasons that the officers have said. I think my concern is genuinely over access. Take all your points, you can't do anything about this on access or fast fabric. I understand that fully. But I'm not happy about the risk of something serious going on there that we have nodded through without due consideration.
Thanks, David. Stu does want to speak on this class. He's been waiting very patiently. So we'll hear from Stuart and then we'll come back to Denise's recommendation for if everybody else.
It was to come back to the issue of David's address and the swimmers of the public. So we were 8 garages and 13 houses. That's 21 potential vehicle rooms, obviously 13 associated with the houses and one of the associated with the garages. Now, it strikes me looking at the plan, Gainsborough here appears to be a cul-de-sac where the access will be from the southeast coming up. Whether or not the site visit struck me that approaching the access point from that direction, you can't actually see if there's any vehicle movements going on in KENILWORTH at that point. So the likelihood of it is that you're attempting to access your garage or your home, that you will swing in to KENILWORTH. And could well, you know, be faced with a vehicle coming towards you. I'm not suggesting the speed will be high enough to produce any sort of personal impact. However, if that's the case, It's potentially going to be here, but the person coming in from engagement would very well feel that he would pass it out into Gainsborough.